A very good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. There are no apologies this morning, and Katie Clark is joining us online. So our first item of business today is to agree to take item 4, which is our review of evidence on today's agenda, in private. Are we all agreed? Okay, thank you. So our first main item of business today is to consider the criminal justice issues raised in the Scottish Mental Health Law Review. And as members will recall, this review was established by the Scottish Government to review existing Scots law with a view to improving the rights and protections of people who may be subject to mental health, incapacity or adult protection legislation by virtue of a mental disorder. And we're joined this morning by Professor Colin Mackay. Professor Mackay is based at the Centre for Mental Health and Capacity Law at Edinburgh Napier University and was a member of the Scottish Mental Health Law Review team. So a warm welcome, Professor Mackay. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I intend to allow around about 45 minutes for this session. So I'd now like to invite Professor Mackay to make some brief opening remarks.
Thank you very much, convener, and thanks very much to the committee for the invitation. I'm really delighted to see an interest in the work of the Scottish Mental Health Law Review, and this is actually, I think, the first committee that started to look at it, so it's great to see that it's starting to be noticed. The review was a large and complex one, a bit of a visual aid. This is a printout with it double-sided and single-spaced. And it probably the largest in this field, because it covered not only the Mental Health Care and Treatment Act of 2003, but also covers adults with incapacity and, to some extent, adult support and protection. So it's a very big and wide-ranging review. So obviously I can only scratch the surface of what the review is about in these opening remarks. We made over 200 recommendations, but there are three broad themes. The first of these is strengthening the voice of people who use mental health services, whether that's people with a mental illness, learning disability, dementia or whatever. The second is reducing the need for and the use of coercion in health and care systems, whether civil or criminal. And the third, and perhaps the most important, is giving effect to the full range of human rights to everybody in the system, including economic, social and cultural rights, such as the right to health and the right to independent living. Now, you can't actually do that by the law alone. That was one of the things that really kind of became apparent as we did our work, that the law needs to be changed, but if the law is to secure the full range of human rights, we also need changes in the culture and shape of services and how services are held accountable. Just say a couple of words about the forensic aspects of the review. In line with our remit, we initially started by looking at the specific forensic disposals in criminal law, which derive mostly from the 2003 Act, and we do make some significant recommendations about them. But I think one of the most stark things that we noticed was there are fewer than 100 of those mental health disposals a year, but there are thousands of people with a mental illness or a learning disability in the criminal justice system, and a lot of evidence that the system doesn't always meet their needs. So we felt we had to make some recommendations across the whole system. So starting with the initial police contact, we actually followed up the work that this committee has already done in its round table last year, and we recommend the development of new models of crisis support to fill the gap between prison and psychiatric hospital. Where people with a mental disability are charged, we want to see a more systematic diversion out of the criminal justice system and greater support for accused persons and indeed victims in court processes. And we've called for changes to avoid people being remanded in prison for lack of a bed, or if sent to hospital, kept in hospital indefinitely awaiting a trial for many months. We do think it's important that there is a specialist mental health disposal as an option for offenders who should be supported and treated in hospital. But we are concerned by the evidence that some people, particularly people with learning disabilities, who receive those kind of disposals, can spend much longer in hospital than they might if they'd received prison sentence and gone through the ordinary system. And for the most serious and risky forensic patients, forensic mental health patients, we propose keeping the special category of restricted patients, but we make a number of recommendations to give more powers to the tribunal to oversee those cases and to reduce the role of ministers in overseeing the cases. We don't say very much in the review about prisons, but that is something that I would urge the committee also to consider. When I was with the Mental Welfare Commission, we saw some very distressing examples of women with serious mental health needs in prison, where prison was not meeting their needs. That was actually drawn to our attention by the European Committee on the Prevention of Torture, and I think that tells you something of the seriousness of it. And I suppose the last point, in terms of reviews, we're not the only review in town. We came on top of the Rome Review of Learning, Disability and Autism in the Mental Health Act, the Barron Review of the Forensic Mental Health System. There's recently been published a review of diversion in prosecution, and around about the same time as our review came out, there was a prison mental health needs assessment. So there's a lot of reviews and a lot of work being done to review the system. So I guess we're at the point now where we maybe need to stop reviewing stuff and start a systematic programme of change. So I hope that's helpful as an outline of our work, and I'm very happy to answer questions. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Professor Mackay. I think that's been a very helpful sort of overview. We'll just move straight to questions, and if I may, I'll kick things off with a question around Section 297 of the Mental Health Act, which is an issue that I've been very interested in for a number of years, which allows an officer to take a person from a public place to a place of safety. And as the review highlights, large amounts of police time are committed to dealing with these types of cases. And you'll know, as you referred to a few moments ago, in May last year, the committee took evidence on this issue, in particular the fact that many people in distress are in their homes in a private place. The review report outlines a range of issues, including police are not best placed to respond, and provisions are being used to respond to people in distress rather than who are experiencing acute mental illness, which is actually the wording in that particular part of the Act. And we note that your review makes some recommendations around this, including that the Scottish Government should work with health and care agencies to develop alternative places of safety for people who are in distress and at risk, who may not necessarily need psychiatric care, and that the Scottish Government should review whether the place of safety powers should extend beyond suspected mental or intellectual disability to other people who may be at serious risk. So that's a rather long-winded introduction to ask you perhaps to outline a little bit more about the work that was done within the review on this particular part of the Act.
Thank you very much. I think the work on places of safety links in with some of the broader work that was done around the scope of the Act and issues around coercion and the use of the state powers, as it were, to try and keep people safe. And I think there's a broad theme that comes through in the work of the review, which is that, in a way, the system kind of works for the people it's designed to work for, and those are perhaps people who do have an acute treatable mental illness, so they have an episode of bipolar disorder or schizophrenia, and need to be in hospital so that they can get some medication so that they can recover and be reintegrated into the community. It doesn't work so well for all the people that doesn't quite fit, so that's people with personality issues, people with comorbidity of substance disorder and so on, and people's problems are, do have mental health needs, absolutely, but don't necessarily need to be treated as inpatients in a psychiatric hospital. And as psychiatric care has developed, I suppose, in a sense. There's a smaller and smaller number of people who fit the bill for acute inpatient treatment in a psychiatric hospital. So we took evidence from a wide range of stakeholders, including people who use services, including people who provide services, and third sector organisations and advocacy organisations and so on. And I say there was a general theme running through the report that I say there's not just in relation to police issues, but the same you could see around child and adolescent mental health services, for example, that the whole system is geared towards getting a referral to the CAM system, and a lot of people then end up being rejected out of the CAM system because they don't meet the criteria for the system. So there's a big gap there. And in a way, the focus on mental illness is perhaps the wrong focus. I know that Dr. Heyman, who gave evidence to you, highlighted this idea that's what she called, I think, the medicalisation of distress. Mm-hmm. And we heard the same evidence that the committee heard about the concerns of the police at the amount of time they spend dealing with people who appear to be in great distress, particularly at risk of suicide. And they feel, and I think even the statement the chief constable made recently prior to his resignation suggested that this idea that police are having to fill in for other agencies is one of the things that they don't think is sustainable. Obviously it's not our place to allocate budgets between the police and the care agencies, but I think certainly the gap between inpatient psychiatric care and the other services that people might need was quite starkly evident, and I think was agreed to by all of the people most of the people that gave evidence to us. So looking at section 297 in particular, again, what was this designed to do? It's designed to address a situation where the police will find somebody, appears to be unwell, appears to be in need of care, and they'll take them somewhere where they'll be looked after. But the reality is that for too many of the people, there isn't anywhere they're going to be looked after, and certainly an acute psychiatric ward or A&E is not the best place to look after them. So the police are left kind of holding the baby as a result of that. They spend a lot of time getting the person to A&E or psychiatric hospital. They spend a lot of time hanging around waiting to see what's going to happen. Then get to, we're not actually going to admit this person. And they're left with a problem. And it's not that we think that there couldn't be any alternatives. I mean, I think there are other ways of conceiving crisis services, whether those, and a lot of those would be places where people might go into on a voluntary basis or might self-refer to. There are one or two examples of crisis services in the country which could be more widely spread. When we talk about coercion, we also talk a lot about, I suppose, the preventive approach, because one of the things we want to do is reduce the amount of coercion in the system. Often, by the time you get to the crisis, there's not much else you can do but use some kind of coercion, whether that's through the police or through mental health detention. But often it could have been prevented if perhaps people had received some support earlier or if there'd been somewhere they could go. So we talk a lot in Chapter 9 of our report about the development of alternatives around safe spaces where people can go if they may feel increasing distress, peer support, all sorts of other ways of thinking about the services.
I'll maybe just come in at that
point. Yeah, I think you should probably stop me. I'm probably going on a bit long.
And we'll maybe come back to what those alternative options and places
Absolutely.
Of safety could look like. Yeah. Just conscious of the time. So I'm going to bring in other members now, and I'm just going to hand straight over to Russell Finlay.
Good morning, Professor. Hi there. Now, your report's now 6 months old. It makes, by my count, 205 recommendations over 115 pages, I think. And even within those recommendations, many of them have got sub-recommendations yes. with, for example, 810 has got 11 specific asks. So it's a huge piece of work, and it's something that I didn't appreciate. I had no real involvement with or knowledge of. But It makes reference to an implementation gap. There's an understanding that what this is seeking to do and how it's delivered might be two different things. Can you give me a sense, 6 months after delivery, what you think the government's position is on a lot of these asks? Have you got a general sense of some of the stuff's never going to see the light of day, or there's a favourable reaction to some of it, or just roughly where you think it's landed, how it's landed?
I don't think I can speak for the government. I mean, I think they are taking it seriously. I think they have officials who are working on this. I understand that the statement I've heard from civil servants is that they hope to publish a more detailed response in the summer, whether that's civil service summer, which takes you into October. But I think they are taking it seriously. I think it doesn't come out of a clear blue sky. I mean, I think a lot of what we recommend builds on other things that are already in the system. So recommendations we make around scrutiny and accountability services, for example, link into other work that they were already doing as a consequence of the investigations into Tayside. As I've said, there is other work that's been done around the forensic mental health system. So it is big and complicated. It isn't totally new, but some of it is quite radical. My sense is, and I think we say something about this in the report, that there are some things that the government should do quite quickly, because there are one or two areas where we think there is a risk of ECHR challenge, for example, around deprivation of liberty. So there are some things where the law does need to be fixed quite quickly. There are some things around service provision, which obviously could be done now. There are other things which we acknowledge would take a long time and a lot of work to develop, and we're talking about 5 years down the line, I would suggest.
So some of the stuff's happening anyway. Some of it can be done within organisations, just cultural changes, yes. And some of it might require legislation.
Yes.
So one other thing that I thought might be worth asking about is the possibility of some kind of online action tracker, so that individuals involved in the report and in the professions and members of the public could see where we are with each of these 200-plus recommendations. Is that something that you would support or have asked for? Has there been any discussion about that?
Well, we haven't asked for it specifically. What we've done within Napier, I mean, obviously the review team has done its job and it's disappeared, as it were, as a review team. And of course, the chair of the review is now a judge. So we, as the review, are done our job. Within Napier, we are helping to support discussions about some of the implementation of the review, and government officials have been very willing and supportive of that. I would absolutely agree it would be helpful to have, I suppose, a fairly systematic response to which of these things. I did see some work that the Royal College of Psychiatrists was doing in terms of thinking about the different recommendations, which are either, you know, well, that's obvious, who could disagree with that, right down to bloody hell, that's a really crazy idea.
And perhaps even like traffic light system, yes. Something that's happened, something, yes. That's in, like we do in the committee with reports. You know?
Yeah, no, yeah. I think some chunking of this up into a programme of change, I think, would be very, very sensible. Yeah,
yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, I'll bring in Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Professor. I wanted to ask you about Chapter 5 of the report, support within the criminal justice system,
yeah.
Specifically in relation to communication with people who have learning difficulties or additional support needs. I have a constituent who currently has a petition going through Parliament. I think the Equalities Committee were talking about it yesterday. My colleague can confirm that. And it's relating to a family member who has had, you know, great distress trying to communicate with the police and carers, actually, because she uses the Makaton signing system. And, you know, my constituent's trying to promote this and say that, you know, the legal advocates and public people dealing with people with mental health should have that ability, or at least some of them. I wonder if you could give me your view on that.
Well, I think certainly in relation to and the expectations of the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, which is one of the things that has kind of guided us. I think it would absolutely be the case that, if people need augmented support needs to communicate, particularly in something as serious as, a police case, then that should be provided and supported. In fact, even, I think, in basic equality legislation, that, should be the expectation that people who have particular support needs. I think there are perhaps two different issues. One is about just the ways in which people might be supported to communicate, and I wouldn't see a difference between that and translation services, for example. Mm-hmm. You know, you'd expect that a person who couldn't speak English
would have an interpreter.
Would have an interpreter. So I think if a person uses Macedon to communicate, then that should be facilitated and supported. There's the other issue, I suppose, in the criminal justice system about what weight do you attach to the evidence of people with intellectual disabilities, mm-hmm. and how much you can say, well, do they really understand what they're telling us? But again, I think that the focus shouldn't be on, as it were, trying to find a way to exclude some people from the system. It should be around how do we support people so that their evidence can be, just as we now take children's evidence much more seriously than, we used to give their evidence. So, yes, I mean, I would think, personally support the idea that those kind of augmented communication aids should be available, and I think it would be something that would reflect our equality or obligations under equality legislation and under the CRPD.
Would you see that as something that needed legislation to introduce, or maybe just an operational, you know, the police service, for instance, said, well, we will have so many officers trained in Macedon or BSL?
Well, I mean, I think practically, yes. I mean, it's perhaps an operational issue. I mean, it may be that, and as we already have the Equality Act, so I suppose the question, I mean, mm-hmm. I think legislation might help, but I think the primary thing would be, and obviously the quicker thing would be, that this becomes part of an operational expectation. Yeah. I mean, as you'll know, I think we already have legislation around the appropriate adult system, which was actually ran for about 25 years on a non-statutory basis, is now statutory, and I would see that as being part of perhaps how the appropriate adult system should be supported. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Thanks. It's very helpful. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks very much. Fulton McGregor, are you wanting to ask us follow-up just to Rona's, and then I'll bring other members in?
Yeah, thanks, convener. Very brief. Just to say and put on the record that I, as a member of the Equalities Committee, that Rona Mackay made reference to there, we actually looked at this petition that she refers to just yesterday again, and just to say on the record that the Equalities Committee has agreed some further work around the area. But the question I did want to ask yourself, Professor Mackay, was, was the review team aware of that petition? And if so, did it take it into any consideration when looking at this particular section?
I'd have to confess, I wasn't aware of it. I don't know if any other members of the review or the Secretariat were aware of it, but it wasn't one that I personally was aware of, I'm afraid.
OK. If you were...
When was the petition raised?
It's been a while, hasn't it?
It's been 2020, it introduced to, and then it's moved on to the Equalities Committee.
All right, apologies that I hadn't picked up on it.
No, that's fine, I just thought I'd ask. That's fine,
Thanks very much. Okay, I think Jamie Green, would you like to come in
now? Please, thank you. Thank you, convener. Good morning, Professor. I wanted to focus on some of your comments that you made in your opening statement around the role of policing and their role as first responders in situations. Certainly, you're right to echo comments by the parting Chief Constable on his concerns over the increasing use of the police as a first port of call for incidents where there's clearly a mental health element, or that is the substantive element of the situation. And how police both deal with those situations, are prepared to deal with such situations, and then what happens thereafter when someone has to be removed from the location to another place and where they go. And there's been a lot of discussion over that over the years, but it seems to me, certainly anecdotally, if not evidentially, that is increasing substantially. I just wondered if you could maybe just talk for a few moments about about the work. I know a big report, lots in it. I know certainly think Chapter 9, for example, went into some of it. There's lots in there, but if you could maybe just sum up what you think the problem is and maybe what government should be thinking about.
Gosh. Well, I think in relation to the police, I suppose there are... I mean, it's a complex, multifactorial problem. It's partly to do with the way that services have developed, I think. And I think this came out in evidence to you. I think as things get tough, people kind of look to their own basis and stop working together quite so much. So they say, well, you know, I can hardly help the people that I'm supposed to help, so I'm not going to take on these other people who might not fit, or I'm not going to do these other things with this other agency when I'm struggling to do my own job. So I think the scope for multidisciplinary working has diminished. I think the complexity of needs has increased. I mean, this has always been a problem, but I think for a number of reasons, the complexity of presentations has increased. And local authority services particularly have obviously had huge pressures on them. So the kind of things that might have been available in the past aren't there. So there's something which is just about the level of resourcing of the system. There's something about the targeting of it towards these people with more, who don't fit well into the boxes that the system provides for them. There are very practical things that can be done to improve the system. The Mental Welfare Commission looked at psychiatric emergency plans. So each health board is supposed to have a psychiatric emergency plan. If it does have one, there's a lot could be done to make those more kind of consistent and cover some of these bases, particularly some of the areas such as what happens if there is a difference of view between the police and the health services about what the needs of a person are, or this is a huge complicating factor, what happens if the person may have a mental disorder but is also intoxicated or has obviously taken something, and what do you do while you're waiting to assess the person? So there are a number of practical things that can be done. And I guess that needs coordination, and it needs, I suppose, central sort of support and encouragement to coordinate that. I think the law can play a part in it, but it's probably not, the biggest thing that needs to be sorted out. I think it's much more about interagency working, trying new things, perhaps. I mean, one of the things that we encouraged was we need to be looking at what people have done in other places. We need to be trying things out. The evidence we had, and I think you perhaps had as well, is that there are pilots around the place, but they never seem to become mainstream. They kind of bubble up and then disappear. So yeah, a lot of it is about better joint working, all the things that we've been talking about since the Christie Commission, I suppose.
Absolutely, yeah. I think we identified that one of the things that was evident is that many of the social services that local authorities provide, or the NHS boards or IGBs provide, are very 9-to-5, Monday to Friday, yeah. And outside of that, there's very little scope to support people, and that's why other emergency services are sucked into that vacuum, if you like, and have to respond. And certainly there was some discussion, a lot of interest, I think, in some of the pilots where police would attend situations where there was a suspicion that perhaps there was no crime being committed, but someone was certainly vulnerable or a danger to themselves or others for the reasons you mentioned, that they would be supported by other bodies or agencies, so sort of triage on the spot system that identified where is the best place to take this person. At the moment, a lot of them seem to end up in police cells,
yeah,
for their own safety as opposed to the safety of the public. And that doesn't, to me, sound like an ideal place to be taking people in that situation.
No, it's absolutely not. I mean, you're right. There have been some, there have been some positive developments. And for example, around, I think Glasgow used mental health nurses, as it were, working alongside police officers, so that where there appears to be an issue of some kind of mental distress, the nurse can intervene perhaps in a way that would be difficult for a police officer to do. I mean, I'm not an expert in the outcomes of that, but some of the stuff I've seen from that suggests that often it's not the They then go on to use the any statutory power to admit people or to detain people, but they're just able to de-escalate the situation or get the person on to some other situation. I mean, I think one of the fundamental things about Section 297 is the great majority of these people do not go on to be detained long-term in the mental health system. So they're there for some other reason, and they need to be in some other place, and I think that's the big gap that needs to be filled. Okay.
I want to talk, if I have time, just ask one more question about prisons.
Yeah.
I think it's quite evident that the prison population, in terms of statistics, is showing us quite worrying trends of those with long-term mental health conditions, history of self-harm, depression, anxiety, and abuse of alcohol and drugs. And some of the statistics I've taken from your report are very interesting. In some cases, almost double the rates of the non-prison population. We also know alongside that there is quite a disparity on the provision of mental health and mental health nurses across the state. And again, there's some statistical data on that, and it ranges, you know, quite varied from sort of one nurse per 53 inmates to one nurse per 177, depending on which prison you're held in, which is a sort of postcode lottery, if you like. And of course, the sad outcome of that is that we have an unfortunately high rate of prison suicide, and many of those are remand prisoners and not even convicted in long-term sentences. I just wondered if you had anything that notable that came out of your investigation to that, that the Scottish Prison Service should be taking note of and the government should be addressing.
Well, I think there's a lot in that. I'd have to say we perhaps didn't look in that in as much detail as we might have liked, but I think there is other evidence. I think particularly the Prison Mental Health Needs Assessment, which was published in October of 2022, I think hits the nail on the head. But I mean, I think that was a very credible report, and that talked about inconsistent and arbitrary resource allocation, support directed to the acutely mentally ill, leaving large number of others without support, limited cross-agency partnership working, the system. And this is something that, when I was with the Mental Welfare Commission, we did come across, places too much emphasis on the person to engage. So they want you to say, you know, I'm feeling suicidal, I'm feeling unwell. Mm-hmm. And there are all sorts of reasons why you might not say that, mm-hmm. including what might happen to you if you're put on suicide watch. And the assessment calls for a fundamental change in approach. And I'd say the numbers issue, there is an issue about small numbers of acutely unwell people who need to be in hospital or need to be out of a prison, certainly. But the wider issue is, as they say, that people in prison are far more likely than not to have a mental health need. So this is not a small subset of the prison population. This is a large proportion of the prison population. And there are big gaps in evidence, particularly around things like neurodevelopmental disorder in young people, and areas of particular risk, as you say, like the remand population. So I think there's a fairly big cluster of issues there. And again, the recommendations of that assessment are the same things. You know, focus on this group, multidisciplinary working, try different ways of moving people through the system, and better ways to listen to people so that we understand when people are in distress and may need some kind of intervention. Mm-hmm. So I think absolutely that needs to be a priority. The Mental Welfare Commission also did a review of the visits to prisons. I think that tells a similar story.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hey, thanks very much. Okay, I'm going to bring Colette Stevenson, followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Professor. I sort of wanted to touch upon prisons as well, but also the sentencing aspect of it. So in the report, it stated that there was very little use of, you know, community disposals, particularly with people with mental health conditions. So do you think that's in relation to the forensic mental health system or the criminal justice more generally, and what do you feel needs to be done about that?
Well, I think there are some quite complicated systemic issues, because in a way, it's not that we don't have the legal options. So there are a number of different community-based disposals which could be put in train for people with mental health needs who offend. So that includes community payback orders with a condition of mental health treatment, compulsion orders, which could be in the community, guardianship under the Adults with Incapacity Act, which might sometimes be relevant for offenders with learning disabilities, particularly. But when you actually count the number of these orders, they're often in single figures in a year, so they're not used. And there are a number of reasons why that might be. I mean, one is that sometimes I think there's a view that because we can't compel somebody to take mental health treatment, they're pointless. I mean, it's kind of toothless sanction. It was striking in the report of the Joint Inspectors into diversion from prosecution that they identified that sometimes having a mental health need or a learning disability was a reason for being excluded from diversion. So there's this kind of sense that we don't have the options for them, so we're not going to use these powers. So I guess the fundamental thing is we need to have a system which provides good options which people could use, which develops good options. I mean, some of it may be that over the years, I think criminal justice social work and mental health social work have slightly diverged. You know, they're kind of almost two different sort of professional paths, and maybe we need to think about bringing them a bit closer together. But, you know, I think unless a sentencer, you know, a sheriff or a judge can see a practical option in front of them, I think a lot of sheriffs might well be happy to consider these kind of disposals, but they need somebody to say, this is something we can offer and we think this has a reasonable shot at working. So it's really around the design and development of those bespoke alternatives for people who have these kind of needs.
Yep. And just on that, I had a conversation as well with Wendy Sinclair Gibbon, the inspector at prisons. And one of the things that we were talking about was, you know, alternative disposals and electronic monitoring, and taking that a step further. So, in terms of their, and I know down in England and Wales, they use a sobriety cuff, but this was tapping more into technology in terms of monitoring a person's sleep. An electronic tag so that they would be in for a certain length of time, but also alerting them as well when they should go and speak to their social worker and whatnot as well. Have you came across anything like that, or was there anything done on that?
I'm certainly aware that there are apps that people can use around monitoring their own mental health. So when people do have perhaps triggers that tell them that they're becoming unwell, I think that is something that's got a lot of work being done on and a lot of research being done on it as a way of helping people maintain their own mental health and to know when to seek help, because obviously when you're becoming ill, that might be when you decide you're not going to seek help. So I haven't heard of it in a criminal justice context. I think that's an interesting idea that maybe is worth following up. I mean, I think for a lot of these things, you obviously need to get the person to buy into the idea that this is something for them. It's not just part of a punitive disposal. But, you know, I think there could be opportunities. I mean, I think those apps are still, you know, in development. I don't know how many of them are fully kind of evidenced and worked through. So, but I think there's certainly creative things that could be tried, I think, around how do we help people to manage their own mental health to stop them from getting into the place that might have got them into trouble before.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Polly McNeill.
Thank you. Good morning, Professor Mackay. It's really excellent work you've been involved in, so thank you very much for that. It was really a follow-on from the convener and Jamie Green, because I'm having difficulty visualising what this might look like. So forgive me to return to the same subject. So as Jamie Green said, so we've heard from the police service, they're 24/7 and they have responsibility to keep people safe. So that's where they're called. They have a duty to come out. So I'm wondering how that's really realistically going to change. So who then would take the place of the police in a different system, and where would they be taken to if it's not A&E? So I'm just not familiar with the types. I mean, I've been in forensic units, familiar with that. I used to represent mental health nurses. I've a bit of a knowledge of that, but I'm thinking maybe we don't have the places. Maybe we shut down too many places when we did the big reforms in the early 90s. So I'm trying to visualise, what does this look like? What other, if it was mental health nurses who took it over, so would they need to change their working pattern then, and would they need new powers for restraint? Because it might be difficult circumstances, and that's why you use the police, because they've got those powers. And clearly we want to avoid taking them to A&E. So anything you can help me with to visualise that would be useful.
Well, I think in terms of replacing the police, I mean, I suspect there will always be a role for the police. And I think the police, and certainly Police Scotland, when we spoke to them, accepted that they, in terms of the immediate crisis, the police and warrant officers have important powers, and public, you know, people know who the police are. And in fact, some of the evidence when I was with the Commission was that people who had been in crisis spoke more positively about the police than they did about some of the other services. So it's not that the police don't have a role, it's that the police's role is the immediate response. And if necessary, I suppose, the getting hold of, whether it's a GP or a nurse or whatever, somebody else who can conduct a medical assessment and then help them work out where a person should go. In some places, sometimes that may not be into some kind of special place. It may just be about how do we help this person calm down so they can the immediate crisis can be managed and they can be linked into services. But I think in terms of the model of services, I think there are different models. There already are kind of crisis services where people can self-refer and just say, this is all too much, but I really don't want to go into a psychiatric hospital. I just want to go somewhere where I can be quiet and get my head straight for a while. There may be other places where, as you suggest, you might need some limited powers of detention or whatever when people are... But might look and feel a bit different from an acute mental health ward. I mean, I'm not really sketching this out in a great deal of detail because I guess I'm probably not competent.
I think, to be honest, what you're illustrating to me is I just don't see how things are going to change, to be honest with you, because if there's no one else to call, if you identify that someone's in distress or they, you know, on the face of it,
yeah,
they've got acute mental health distress. So in the circumstances where you would use the Section 297, right? Who else would you? Who else would you contact? Surely, then the only way this can change is if you're giving an alternative to 101 or 999, call someone else. Otherwise, it's always going to fall back on the police. I can't see how that could possibly change.
But I think the problem with the police is not answering the call. The problem for the police is then spending the rest of the shift following the person around,
right,
because they can't get them into somewhere. So I think it's about having somewhere where the police can lock into health and social care services, which will pick up the issue and will support people. And that could be through the third sector. But it needs to be an integrated system rather than having the police as the fallback right through, you know. I think the evidence is that people, the average time they spend on a case like this is about 7.5 hours. So it is basically a shift that people are... police officers are spending dealing with these crises. So
the only way that can change then is if the police take the initial call and they hand over to someone else then?
Yes. Well, it wouldn't always be the police, but yeah, I think in a lot of cases if it could be the police taking the initial call. But
Who would that be then? What service would that be to, do you think?
It would have to be... supported either by the health service or by social work services, but it could be a third sector service.
Do you think that's quite a radical change then to make? I don't know enough to know.
It potentially is quite a radical change, but I don't think it's completely unheard of. I mean, I think if you look back in history, I think there have been services that are a bit like this, these kind of more informal crisis services, and they've tended to disappear as services have had to focus in on the more, you know, mainstream specialised services. So.
Do you feel optimistic? Because from what I'm hearing, I'm not that optimistic that things can change, because what the evidence we've heard is the police are the last responders for everything,
yes,
including this.
Yes.
So for this to change, there has to be a structural change in service. Otherwise, we'd be back to, and I don't see.
Well, I think it's about, I suppose, you know, one of the arguments is we're spending a lot of money doing the wrong things. And so if you could spend some of that money doing the right things, you might see a change. But I agree with you, we'd need a structural change in the kind of services that are on offer, I think.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's just brought us up to our 45 minutes, nice and neatly. So thank you very much indeed, Professor Mackay, for attending today's meeting. I'm sure that members may have some follow-up questions, which we'll write out on to you. But thank you again, and we'll just have a very short suspension. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, members. So our next agenda item is consideration of the timetable for the implementation of the various provisions in the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Articles Scotland Act of 2022. And as the committee will recall, we were the lead committee for the scrutiny of the bill, and the Scottish Government undertook to keep us updated on the implementation of its various provisions, and I refer members to Paper 3. So can I just invite views or questions or comments from members on the update that has been provided? Jamie Green.
Thank you, Convener. Can I thank the Minister for Community Safety for the update on Valentine's Day? It was a welcome gift, I have to say. I actually didn't spot this until the committee papers came out, but I did want to comment on the content of the letter. Perhaps pose a few questions that we could ask the Minister to expand. There's a lot in here. The first relates to the first main paragraph around what appears to be the only bit of the bill that was passed that did come into force was the proxy purchase and emergency worker aggravation measures, which we passed and to be fair to the former minister, I'm grateful to the government for including a request. Mm-hmm. I did wonder, though, it would have been helpful if we perhaps had some data on whether that was a worthwhile exercise or not. Certainly, I've chucked in a few questions into the system, but perhaps the minister could make it easier for us and enlighten us if there were any offences around proxy purchase or attacks on emergency service workers. Now, at the time of Bonfire Night, tail end of last year, we know there were some high profile incidents because we discussed them in the chamber and they were reported widely in the media. What is unclear, though, and I appreciate it's only a few months ago and these things take time to come through the justice system, but I'd be really intrigued to know if any of the emergency worker aggravation measures actually will come into play in any of these cases. And I guess what we talked about a lot in the preparation of the report and as the passage of the bill was how many incidents are reported and the conversion rate into charges prosecutions, convictions and what the sentences look like. And I'd be interested to see a piece of work on that at some point this year. The second point was the next paragraph, where the Minister states, and I quote, "The ongoing unprecedented challenging financial context is impacting our ability to implement the remaining measures of the bill," unquote. Well, I just want to dig a little bit further. What are these ongoing unprecedented challenging financial contexts? So what specifically is the Minister talking about? Now, I think if the answer to that is inflation, well, I think that's a bit too generic. If it's a freeze on that directorate's budget, if it's a reduction in the amount of money that was available, this really comes back to the financial memorandum, which lots of us raised during the passage of the bill, as always is the case with these things, is seem to be underestimating perhaps the overall potential financial ramifications of the bill. It seems to me that perhaps that is actually coming to pass. But again, there may be valid defence in here, but it doesn't say what it is. So I would like some more information from the Minister exactly as to what are these challenges and why are they stretching the original anticipated timescales. The next point are around the issues that have been delayed, and it's clear that quite a few things have been delayed now. The firework control zones apparently will commence this year, but we were promised that we would see both guidance and a framework around that. I think we will need that in quite a timely manner to interrogate the government on those and to perhaps even speak to stakeholders. We did try to, some of us tried to put it on the face of the bill that should be part of a valid scrutiny. What I don't want to see is these things just getting chucked in as SSIs at the last minute where we haven't had any time to properly scrutinise them, because the firework control zones are quite a big part of it. I note the delay to the licensing system. That's not a huge surprise to me, I'm sure. It's unclear what the delay is. Is that related to financial? Is it related to disagreements with local authorities? Is it technical issues, IT issues? Are there any concerns that have been raised by anyone? Or is it just that it's just taking longer than the government thought, which is a valid reason? And the final issue that I wanted to raise is around the restricted days of supply and use. Again, that was another controversial element of the bill that we talked about at great length. There were very mixed views on it, and of course the effect that had on retailers, both online and physical retailers. It just says here that that's been paused to future financial year. That sounds very much to me like it's been kicked into the long grass. It's a very polite way of saying we're not doing it at the moment and I'm not sure when we're going to do it. So perhaps the Minister could provide a little bit more information about pause to a future financial year. Future financial year could be any time in the century. So, is there a bit of backtracking going on here? Are there some issues? Have there been any legal challenges? Because some of us warned there may be. Again, I hope that there's nothing untowards happening here that would cause issues for the government. So I just think, it's a helpful letter, but it raises more questions than answers. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I think, Russell, you want to come in?
Thank you. Yeah. Begin by noting the irony that the Minister responsible for trying to curtail fireworks is now putting on such an entertaining display as she seeks to become First Minister. Now, turning to Eleanor Whittam's letter, there's a lot in here and it's really quite concerning. Remember, this legislation was rushed. We felt, I think collectively, that there wasn't appropriate necessary time for all the scrutiny that was required. We were told there's nothing to worry about, they would fill in the details later, and here we are with a letter that fails, frankly, to do so. Jamie Green's touched on some of this already, but going to the bullet points at the bottom of page 2, the Minister talks about a slight delay to implementation of the licensing scheme, which is kind of one of the central planks of the legislation. So my understanding is this would have come in this year, but now won't be until next year, quote, at the earliest. So that seems a bit open-ended. And even more vague is the final bullet point, which is around the restriction of days of supply and use. You'll recall that these related to specific cultural, religious and events and so on. And It says it's been paused for a future financial year, but doesn't say which, even as I kind of guess. So it'd be nice to know if they could give us some indication as to which one they're working towards. Is it, like the previous point, 2024? Or is it going to be even further down the field, down the line, or even perhaps, as Jamie suspects there, that it might not happen at all? I think when you take all of these implementations, the fact we warned about the confusion of what's being brought forward, I think the confusion will be even greater when the public are only going to get this stuff coming in piecemeal. The plan was to bring in the proxy purchasing in year one and the aggravation for emergency service workers, and then bring in all the other stuff together in year two, as in this year, and that's now not happening. It was already confusing. It's going to become even more confusing. And I think the letter, if you read it, you just think it's all perfectly fine, and it's far from it. There's clearly big problems around delivery, as we warned. So we really need to drill into as much detail as possible as to what the timescales are and why the delays are happening.
Thanks, Russell. Fulton.
Thanks, Camino. I thank the Minister for the letter as well. It's a bit of a mixed bag. We've heard a more kind of critical view so far, but in terms of the first two bullet points, Russell Finlay was also referring to there in terms of the bullet points. I think that's good, and it's reassuring that that some of the provisions will come in before the for bonfire night, which is obviously the season that's been targeted. And also the pirated possession offence. I think that's positive. But in terms of the last two points, I do find myself agreeing with colleagues who have already spoken. It's a bit watery. I mean, even in terms of the licensing system, which was a key part of the legislation, even saying that it will commence mid-2024 at the earliest, I'd rather it was maybe that we're going to be working to mid-2024 for definite. There could be mitigating circumstances, and then of course in the final one, I just don't think it's good enough to say that it could be in a future year. We need a wee bit more definitive. So a mixed bag for me in terms of this letter, convener, and given the work that this committee and all of us put into this legislation, it's good to see some of it coming forward, and we hope that will make a difference to our constituents. But there's areas that need tightened up on to write back to the minister.
Thanks very much. And Pauline, I think you wanted to come in as well.
Yeah, thank you. So I welcome the fact that a letter sets it out quite clearly. I think I take it, my reading of the financial context, it seems to be about the implementation, but it would be good to get that clarified. So I welcome the fact that fire control zones will commence. I suppose the test for me is whether or not they're going to be used by local authorities. So that's what I'm interested in. And the offence. I really had concerns about the licensing system anyway, so I'm not concerned at all about the delay in that. And also we had raised concerns about the costs as well, and I wouldn't be happy if those powers were used without having some indication of the costs of the scheme. So I'm actually quite supportive of the content of the letter. I think it's an interesting lesson. I think for people who observe the legislative process, you think you've passed all the laws, but no, you haven't, because what matters is when do they draw the powers down for each section of the Act through the statutory. So that's what the letter clearly sets out. So just thought I'd add that in.
Thank you very much indeed. Okay, thank you, members. I probably concur with pretty much all of the comments that have been made. I think, Jamie, your suggestion around looking perhaps at some data in relation to the provisions around emergency workers and proxy purchase provisions is a good suggestion, and I'd be happy to take that forward. I do think it would be, this is a bit light touch, and it would be helpful to have more detail, in particular around some of the key sort of points that members have raised, but really, I think, across the committee, we've got various levels of concern about pretty much all the sort of key updates that were provided. So I'm happy for us to write to back to the Minister, seeking some data, as Jamie outlined, but more detail on the key points that were outlined in the correspondence, and also a reassurance that every effort will be made to keep the timescales on track and minimise slippage, given, I think, the public interest in this issue in particular. And Pauline, on that point about costs, I think that's a well made and we'll incorporate that into our correspondence. And I think, Katie, you're in agreement with the suggestion around contact with the Minister by way of a follow-up letter. Okay. Jamie.
Thank you, if I may. I mean, we just spent 20 minutes talking about a letter. If the Minister was sitting here, we probably could have resolved all these issues without the need of further communication. I mean, if the Minister so feels the need, she'd be very welcome to come and talk to us. It would save the need of the ping-pong of letters back and forward where people, you know, can hide behind niceties that don't mean anything, which is what you often get in these civil service drafted letters, no disrespect to them. But, you know, maybe we could just ask some direct questions of the Minister, and she's welcome to be accompanied by advisers if so need be. But, you know, we could probably settle this matter quite easily with an appearance from the Minister, perhaps tied in with some other issues. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. That's noted. Okay, thank you very much. That concludes our public items, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.